Good morning, good morning. Let's worship our Lord this morning.
Oh, these are the days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. And these are the days of your servant Moses, righteousness being restored. And oh, these are days of great trials, of famine and darkness and sore. Still we are the voice in the desert crying, prepare ye the way of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. Let the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. These are the days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. And these are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, the fields are as wide in the world. And we are the laborers in your vineyard, declaring the word of the Lord. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, lift your voice. It's a year of jubilee, and out of Zion's hill salvation comes. Behold, he comes, riding on the clouds, shining like the sun. At the trumpet call, one day the trumpet will sound for his coming. One day the skies with his glories will shine. Wonderful day, my beloved one bringing. My Savior Jesus is mine.
One day when heaven is filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. The word became flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. One day they led him up Calvary's mountain, one day they nailed him to die on a tree. Suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is he. Hands that heal nations stretched out on a tree, took the nails for me. Living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried he carried my sins far away.
No longer. One day the stone rolled away.
Death could not hold him, grave could not keep him rising again. Living, he loved me, dying, he saved me, buried, he carried my sins far away. Rising, he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day. Day my beloved one bringing, Jesus. My Savior Jesus is mine.
Lord Jesus, we are looking forward to that glorious day. I thank you that we can sing, living he loved me, dying he saved me, buried, carried my sins far away. Thank you, Lord, for carrying my sin far away by dying on that cross. Lord, we love you. We thank you for what you're going to do in this place this morning. He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah. The bread, his blood, the wine, broken and poured out all for love. And the whole earth trembled, and the veil was torn. Love so amazing. Love so amazing. Jesus Messiah. Blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sinners, the ransom from heaven, Jesus Messiah. Sinners, you're the ransom from heaven.
Messiah, Lord of all. Oh, Jesus, Messiah, Lord of all of creation, all of the earth, make straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinner, wake up the saint. Let every nation shout of your fame. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so come, Lord Jesus. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. When there will be justice, all will be new. Your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride ready for you, every heart longing for our King. We sing, even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come.
So we wait.
So we wait. We wait for you, God, we wait, you're coming soon. So we wait for you, God, we wait, you're coming. Bride waiting for a groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing. Like a bride waiting for a groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus, come.
Father God, my prayer is that we would be ready, that we would be a church that's ready for you when you come back. Pray for every person that's in here, every person that's watching online right now, that each person in here will have asked you to be their Lord and Savior before you come back, Lord. Let us be a church that is ready. ready for you, Lord. Us in the areas where we need to be encouraged. Lord, convict us where we need to be convicted. Give us rest, Lord. Give peace to the people who need just a calm heart right now. Lord, teach us this morning. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Y'all can be seated.
Well, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Oh, did I catch you by surprise? Let's try that again. Good morning, everyone. There we go. There's the church. If you have not yet heard, it is my sad duty to tell you that one of our own has been called home and is resting now in his new mansion with the Lord Jesus Christ. Bill Slater passed away a few days ago. His memorial service will be here Thursday, the 5th of August. Viewing will be from 9:30 to 10:30, and then the service will begin at 10:30. You are invited to attend if you would like. In fact, would you join me in praying for his family right now? Father, we lift up to you the Slater family, and we pray your word over them that says, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted." Father, we ask for the comfort and the peace that surpasses all understanding that comes from you and you alone. And Father, as the church is praying together, we lift up all those that are in need of healing, those who are affected by COVID-19, or I pray for my father who has another illness, and those who are in the hospital. Father, we lift all of them up, and we pray for healing. We thank you that you give us the ministry of prayer, that we have the assurance that you not only hear but answer. And as we do every time the church prays, Father, we pray for our nation. And Lord, we ask for a revival. We ask that in Jesus' name, and all the people of God said, amen. Can you believe today is the 1st of August? Where has the year gone? I read a Facebook meme that was like, can you believe it's August? Oh, Christmas. Happy New Year. And I'm like, yeah, that's kind of how it feels here. It's just flying by. On the first of every month, the first Sunday of every month, we as a church, we celebrate the Lord's Supper. And one of the things I love most about celebrating the Lord's Supper together is that it presents so many different aspects of Jesus. You have a past, a present, and a future. And it's appropriate that we use the Lord's Supper as a reminder of what Jesus did for us when he died on the cross to pay the penalty for our sins. And the bread and the cup, they're a powerful object lesson that remind us that, of the price God paid in order for us to have a relationship with him. And then there's that present aspect of the Lord's Supper that causes us, or should cause us, I hope, to reflect on our own relationship with God and to make sure that we have dealt with the sin that is in our own lives so that we don't take the elements, the bread and the fruit of the vine, in an unworthy manner, as the Bible says. And actually, I hope and pray that you've developed a habit in your life to constantly bring your life before God, not just to prepare for the Lord's Supper, but to maintain your fellowship with him on a consistent basis. But I think perhaps the most neglected aspect of the Lord's Supper is the future element of the ordinance. And that's where I want us to focus our time together this morning, on that future element of the ordinance. So I'm going to begin this morning by reading out of Matthew's account of the Passover meal. We'll find this in Matthew 26, verses 26 through 29. Then we're going to go ahead and partake of the bread. So you'll just take the top portion of your handy-dandy communion COVID cup. Didn't quite mean it that way, but you got the idea. We'll just be doing the bread. Then I'm going to go through this message, and then we'll finish with the fruit of the vine. So as I read here, it says, "Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.' And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he'd give it to them, saying, 'Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom.'" So before we begin the bread in just a moment, let me share a word with the church this morning, a word of instruction, a word of warning, however you want to see it. The Bible is quite clear that only those who have committed their lives to Jesus as Lord and Savior are to partake of the Lord's Supper. In fact, the only people we see in Scripture partaking in the Lord's Supper are baptized believers. So if you've made that decision, regardless of whether or not you're a member of this church, we invite you to join us in taking of the bread and the cup. However, if you've not made that commitment in your life, I'd ask you to consider to refrain from taking the bread and the cup. I encourage you to participate otherwise. In fact, it's my prayer that God will use this time to draw you to Him so you will make that commitment in your life. Now, Matthew records that on the night Jesus took the bread, blessed it, and then divided it among His followers. Father, we come to you now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, thankful for the symbolism of the Lord's Supper, the bread and the fruit of the vine. We thank you, Lord, for His body that was nailed to the cross, by whose stripes we are healed. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen.
Behold the Lamb who bears our sins away, slain for us. And we remember the promise made that all who come in faith find forgiveness at the cross. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink of His sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of peace around the table of the King. The body of our Savior Jesus Christ, torn for you. Eat and remember the wounds that heal, the death that brings us life. Pay the price to make us one. So we share in this bread of life, and we drink of His sacrifice as a sign of our bonds of love around the table of the King.
Now, as they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and after blessing it, broke it, and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body." We're going to take a little time now to focus this morning on verse 29. Where Jesus told His disciples that He would not drink again of the fruit of the vine until the day that He would drink it with them in His Father's kingdom. What exactly did Jesus mean by that? And how should what He meant by that, how should that impact us in the way we live our lives right here and right now? I mean, this is more than history. This is here and now. And most importantly, I think, for us this morning is, how should this impact the way we observe the Lord's Supper in the church? And I think, I hope I'll be able to demonstrate quite clearly this morning that there is little doubt in my mind that Jesus is referring to, in that verse, in verse 29, to what is known as the marriage supper of the Lamb. How many of you have heard of that before, the marriage supper of the Lamb? It's described for us, actually, in Revelation 19, verse 1 through 9. I'm going to read that next. I want you to keep in mind as I read it, though, that those present at that first Passover meal, that Lord's Supper, they didn't have the benefit of being able to read Revelation. Revelation 19. After these readings, I heard a loud voice of a great multitude in heaven saying, "Hallelujah! Salvation and glory and honor and power belong to the Lord our God. For true and righteous are His judgments, because He has judged the great harlot who corrupted the earth with her fornication, and He has avenged on her the blood of His servants shed by her." Again they said, "Hallelujah! Her smoke rises up forever and ever." And the 24 elders and the four living creatures fell down and worshiped God who sat on the throne, saying, "Amen, hallelujah." Then a voice came from the throne saying, "Praise our God, all you His servants, and those who fear Him, both small and great." And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and the sound of many waters, and as the sound of mighty thundering, saying, Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigns. Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has made herself ready. And to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. And then he said to me, write, blessed are those who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said to me, these are the true sayings of God. And I fell at his feet to worship him. But he said to me, see that you don't do that. I'm your fellow servant and of your brethren who have the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. It'd be real easy today to get caught up in some good eschatological teaching about Revelation related to the marriage supper of the Lamb, like when exactly will it occur and all those details, and I'm not going to do that today. I'll do that at an appropriate time when we're doing a Revelation study, perhaps in a few weeks. We'll deal with those issues. This morning, I want us to focus on the connection between the Lord's Supper and the marriage supper of the Lamb. And in order to do that, you really have to have a working understanding of a Jewish wedding at the time of Jesus. How many of you are Jewish? And how many of you lived during the time of Jesus? All right, then you all should be paying attention right now. So it was that whole marriage thing back in Jesus' time, a Jewish wedding, was much different than the typical wedding that we experience in our culture today. And if we don't understand the differences, it's going to be impossible for us to make the connection between the Lord's Supper and the marriage supper of the Lamb. So in the Jewish wedding process, first, there was a contract. So the marriage process began with the establishment of a contract that was negotiated between the families, and included in the contract was the bride price. How would that go today? Well, what do you want to give me? Well, which one? The oldest one, I'll say. Oh, that one's going to be like, brand new car, and how would you negotiate? Anyway, they negotiated the bride price, similar to a dowry, and in that culture, the bride price represented an appropriate amount to compensate the parents for raising the daughter. I guess that would depend on what restaurants they went to. What is the cost to raise a child? I don't even want to know that number, actually. So it would compensate the parents for the cost of raising their daughter, as well as being an expression of love of the groom toward his bride. So that's how this thing begins, with this contract. Everybody with me? How many dads are figuring out what they can get for their daughters right now? After the contract, there was the acceptance portion of the contract. So once the contract was agreed upon, listen carefully though, because you're going to start to see how these tie together. The young groom then would pour a glass of wine for his beloved, and if she accepted the marriage proposal, the contract, she would drink the glass of wine to indicate her acceptance. If she did not drink the wine, the marriage contract was immediately canceled. So a contract is established, confirmed with the drinking of wine. If she drinks the wine, it's accepted. If she doesn't, it's rejected. At that time, once the bride drank the cup, the betrothal period commenced. It's kind of like our engagement, but different. The betrothal was a legally binding contract, and in order for that to be dissolved, you had to have an actual divorce based on the proper grounds, such as infidelity, in order to break the contract. So though they weren't married, it was though there was a marriage contract already in place. In order to break the betrothal, there had to be a divorce. Actually, you see that in the account, you might remember, of Mary and Joseph. When Joseph decided he was going to divorce Mary, though the wedding itself had not yet taken place. And I always wondered, well, why would he divorce her if they're not yet married? Because that was his betrothed. So there's your answer. So the betrothal period would normally last between 1-2 years. And actually, there's some reasons for that, why it was so long, and you're going to hear about those next. Everybody with me? Okay, so we had the contract, then the acceptance, and then the betrothal period. And then you have the preparation of the wedding chamber. So the young groom, now betrothed, his betrothed love has drank her wine, and everything's in place. He goes home, back to prepare a place for his bride. and then he would return for her when this place was ready. So he'd go to his parents' house, where he would build a wedding chamber or a honeymoon room there. And the room had to be constructed well to get his father's approval before he could return to his bride. So if someone were to ask him, hey, what day are you getting married, or when's the wedding? He would say, only my father knows. I'm hoping I'm making some impact on some of you. Because only the father could approve the room being ready. In the meantime, the bride, she would be preparing herself for the wedding. So she'd partake what in Hebrew is called mikvah, or a cleansing bath. She would purchase expensive cosmetics and learn to apply them in order to be beautiful for her husband. Her mother would teach her about what would be expected of her as a wife. And during this time, she was considered, she was consecrated or set apart, and she had to wear a veil whenever she was in public so that others would know that she was betrothed. And since she didn't know when the groom was coming, she would always have to be ready, because the groom would typically come for her in the middle of the night. You know, I've been thinking of that. I think there's some correlation between arriving to boot camp in the middle of the night, too. And it's always the same way. And I'm not exactly sure what the parallel is, but anyway, the groom would always arrive in the middle of the night, and she would have to leave her lamp and her belongings ready all the time. And her sisters or bridesmaids, who were also expected to be virgins, had the wicks of their candles trimmed in anticipation of the coming of the groom. And then after all that, we get to the wedding. When the wedding chamber was ready, the groom would get permission from his dad to go get his wife, and off he'd go. He'd go to claim his wife. And this usually took place in the middle of the night, as I said. And as the groom, along with his friends, approached the house of the bride, they would shout and blow the shofar, the ram's horn, to let her know that they were approaching, so she would be ready. And when the wedding party arrived at the father's house, the newlyweds went into the wedding chamber for a seven-day honeymoon. And the groom's best friend stayed outside waiting for the groom to tell him that the marriage had been consummated. The family and the friends would celebrate for 7 days while the bride and groom enjoyed their seven-day honeymoon in their wedding chamber. And at the end of that period, the husband would bring out his bride and introduce her to the community. 7 days. Then, after all that, is the marriage supper. After the seven-day honeymoon, the wedding process concluded with the marriage supper. And this was a time of a joyous celebration and feasting. It would have been at that type of marriage feast, this supper, where Jesus performed his first miracle by turning what? Water into. So I've described the process. And if you're anything like me, you've had a number of scriptures, passages come to mind that directly related to the process that can only be understood correctly by keeping this Jewish wedding process in mind. Now, we can't scratch the surface on all those passages, but we'll come back to them one day. What I want us to do this morning is to focus narrowly on this process to help us understand Jesus' comment in Matthew 26, verse 29, and how that ties in with the marriage supper of the Lamb that I've already read you in Revelation chapter 19. So, the primary context of that meal Jesus shared with his disciple was the Passover. His followers would have also been very familiar with the Jewish wedding process. So when Jesus offered the cup to them there in that upper room, they understood the symbolism of the cup, both in the context of the Passover and in the context of the marriage process. Now, Jesus had established a contract. Remember how the wedding process started? Established a contract with his followers, and he was about to go pay the bride price on their behalf as an expression of his love for them. And when he offered them the glass of wine, they then had to choose whether or not they were going to accept that contract. And if you read the gospel accounts carefully, you'll find that one of the 12 never did drink of the cup. After dipping his bread, which had occurred in the Passover meal, prior to drinking the cup of redemption, which occurred after the meal, the scripture says that Judas left to betray Jesus. So he never accepted the offer of the wine. But the other 11 did. They did exactly that. They accepted the contract when they drank the cup. And at least part of which we do each time we take the cup is to acknowledge to Jesus that we too are accepting the salvation that he's offered to us by paying the bride price on our behalf. And when Jesus said that he would not drink of the fruit of the vine again until he would drink it with them in his Father's kingdom, he clearly has the marriage supper of the Lamb in mind. And his disciples, even though they didn't have the benefit of reading Revelation 19, which describes the feast, they would have understood what Jesus was saying based on their familiarity with the prophecy of Isaiah, which we're going to see in Isaiah chapter 25, verses 6 through 9. It says, "On this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, of rich food full of marrow, of aged wine well refined. And he will swallow up on this mountain the covering that is cast over all peoples, the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever. And the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces, and the reproach of his people he will take away from all the earth. For the Lord has spoken, and it will be said on that day, behold, this is our God. We have waited for him that he might save us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation." In that prophecy, Isaiah describes a time when God would prepare this great feast for the people of all nations who he saved through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And at that feast, Jesus, along with his followers, will once again drink the well-aged wine for the first time since he ascended to be with the Father at his resurrection. So this morning, in just a few moments, we're going to take the cup. And it should be a time of anticipation as we look forward to that time when Jesus will invite us to partake of the cup in his presence at the marriage supper of the Lamb. So what does that mean for us today? Well, there's some important implications for us right here and right now as we await that day, that glorious day. So let's go back once again to Revelation 19 and focus this time just on the end of verse 7 and verse 8. It says, "And his bride has made herself ready." Listen to the words carefully. "It was granted her to clothe herself. It was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure. For the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints." How does this affect us today? John's describing in this, he's describing us in this passage. You and I are the bride of Christ. And we are to be preparing ourselves for the time when the groom Jesus returns to us. And in this verse, we find what's required of us during this time of waiting, this time of preparation. This passage, to me, is one of the clearest in all of the Bible that describes the relationship between the sovereignty of God and man's will. Calvinists, listen carefully here. This describes very well the relationship between the sovereignty of God and the will of man. On one hand, we as the bride, it says, we are to clothe ourselves, our own volition, with the fine linen that represents our righteous deeds. But it also says that we can only do that because we have been granted that ability to do that by our God. Notice it said, it was granted to her to clothe herself. A couple other familiar passages that reinforce that same principle that comes to mind. Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. You know the verse. It is, "For by grace you've been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It's the gift of God. Not as a result of works, so that none of you may boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." So the entire process of salvation is a gift from God. And even our ability to have faith in Jesus, that's not of our own doing either. But as it's a result of being given that gift. We have a responsibility, therefore, we have a will, we have a responsibility ourselves, you and I, to choose to use that gift for the purpose of carrying out God's work here on earth. Or as John described it in Revelation, the righteous deeds of the saints. Therefore, my beloved, Philippians chapter 2, verse 12. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, see now, not only in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. The same principles at work there. It is only God working in us that gives us both the wisdom to know what pleases him and the power to carry it out. But we are the ones ultimately responsible to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling as we carry out the righteous deeds of the saints. So we've taken the cup today. We acknowledge Jesus' work in his life, in our life, and his free gift of salvation bought for us by him paying the bride price. But there's also a sense in which we are also making a commitment to him that when we come to the table, we make a commitment to live our lives in a way that will consistently carry out what John called the righteous deed of the saints to the very best of our ability while we wait his return and prepare ourselves for the marriage supper of the Lamb. Would you please pray with me? Father, it's difficult for us, particularly us men, to see ourselves as the bride of Christ. But we thank you for a picture that we can understand. And Father, we thank you that you sent your only begotten Son to pay the bride price for us. And that you'd offer his blood, which is symbolized by the fruit of the vine, for us. And that you've empowered each one of us to choose him by accepting the wine. And Father, we commit as a church to prepare ourselves for the coming of the groom, when he will invite us to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And until then, Lord, we ask your presence in our lives as we do the righteous deeds of the saints. I pray for any man or woman here this morning that have never come to a saving relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ on their own volition, not relying on baptism or being raised in church or any other circumstance except for their own will, choosing Jesus. If you're making that choice this morning, you can say, Father, I choose you. I choose Jesus. I accept the price that he paid as the price for my sins, and I thank you for them. And I place my faith in him, his body, his blood, for my salvation. In Jesus' name, amen.
The blood that cleanses every stain of sin shed for you. Drink and remember, he drained death's cup that all may enter in to receive the life of God. So we share in this bread of life and we drink. Table of the King.
And he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins.
And so with thankfulness and faith we rise to respond and to remember our call to follow in the steps of Christ as his body here on earth. And we share in his sufferings. We proclaim that Christ will come again and will join in the feast of heaven around the table of the King.
The Apostle Paul wrote that as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And all God's people said, amen. Let's see, announcements. I know there's a bunch I'm supposed to remember, and I'll probably forget them all. I did tell you that about the service on Thursday at 9:30 to 10:30 is viewing. 10:30 begins the service right here in church for Bill Slater. Men, we're on a regular schedule tomorrow night, and we'll be actually doing our second drawing for a shotgun in the God and Guns Bible Reading Challenge. If you did not receive the email, and you expected to receive the email asking whether you've been keeping up with your reading in order to be in the drawing, you can actually go to blastandcast.org or our church's website under resources, and there's a link there that you can click where we will get your name and be able to add it in the drawing. You have until 3 p.m. tomorrow to get into the drawing. Now, we'll be doing another drawing in a few weeks and then a fourth drawing at the end, but pretty exciting. So, guys, 6:30, regular time, 7 o'clock. We'll start our recap of last week's reading in the Bible Reading Challenge. And we've had to postpone the new women's Bible study, Queries of the Omniscient, from this Sunday to next Sunday. And we did that because there was a conflict with the online portion of that being during the time of Bill's service, so it made sense to move it. Are there any other announcements that need to be made that I'm forgetting? So, I know of one birthday. Are there any other birthdays here? Then Evie, would you please stand on the chair? This is the only time you'll ever get invited to stand on a chair, and now she won't do it. This is like the most not shy child in all of the world. Yeah. She is 5 years old today. So let's sing happy birthday to Evie. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. I can't believe she's being shy. We're going to end our service together by reading from the Word of God. I would like you to put up Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. Would you all please stand? And read with me, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works so that no one may boast, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Go with God, everyone. Have a great day.